so great for the ministry of music at this church. The Lord is my heart to hear such beautiful voices of angels. And I praise God. If I had not already planned to sing, I would not. That just sets me right where I want to be for this sermon. That musical selection. And I'm going to bring the offering today because it goes with my message. And it's one of my favorite songs. One of my most favorite songs to sing. Many of this one I love to sing. I pray that you're blessed by it today. Thank you. God for his amazing grace. I tell you, that's why I stand here before you today. Because of his grace. And I'm a testimony. I'm a witness. If someone would give their lives over to God, he can take you from nothing and use you for his glory. It's communion Sabbath, and we don't want to be terribly long today, but I do have a message I believe that God has for us this morning. Our scripture reading is taken from Luke chapter 7, verse 36 through 39. I'm going to read in the hearing. It says, when one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. A woman in that town who lived a simple life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she came there with an alabaster box, jar of perfume. As she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. I'm going to stop there with verse 38. Let's pray. Father, we ask that you may be with us as we reflect on your grace. Amen. Luke is the gospel of nobodies. Luke was a Gentile, and he wrote the book for Gentiles. He was the only Gentile contributor to the New Testament. He wanted to create a comprehensive account of the life of Jesus the Christ to strengthen the faith of Gentile believers and stimulate faith among non-believers. More than any other gospel, Luke devoted more of his writing to Christ's feelings and humanity. Luke portrays Jesus as a man with compassion for all people. See, whereas Matthew traces Jesus' genealogy back to Abraham, the father of the Hebrew people, Luke traces it back to Adam, the father of the human race. Luke is also the most socially minded of the Gospels. In Luke, Jesus blesses the poor, the hungry, those who weep, and the excluded. Today, Christianity in America is more closely associated with the rich and powerful than with the poor and the outcasts. But in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus criticizes the rich for they think life consists of possessing things. He says, woe to you who are rich, but blessed are you if you are poor, forsaken, cast aside by society, and destitute, all in the book of Luke. And it is in this context where we pick up a very interesting story about God and his concern for the outcasts. The Bible reads, verse 36, when one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. You see, a Pharisee was a member of an ancient Jewish sect, distinguished by strict observance of the traditional and written law, and commonly held to have pretensions to superior sanctity, a self-righteous person. Origin Latin from the Greek pharisaos, it means separated ones. The Pharisees was one of Christ's bitterest enemies. It was this group, when Jesus had healed a demoniac, they accused Jesus of casting out demons by the prince of demons. It was the Pharisees who always questioned the authority of Jesus' doctrine. It was the Pharisees who said to Jesus' disciples, "Why does your master eat with tax collectors and sinners?" The Pharisees were always accusing Jesus. The Pharisees were always seeking for a sign to believe. But Jesus' views on them weren't positive either. Jesus called them brood of vipers and snakes. In Matthew chapter 23, Jesus spoke to his disciples and he said, "They, the Pharisees, sit in Moses' seat, so you must be careful to do everything they tell you, but do not do what they do, for they do not practice what they preach." It was of the Pharisees Jesus said, "You are like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of the bones of the dead and everything unclean." We must be careful in the church that our devotion to God doesn't cause us to be a curse to our fellow man. But despite all of this baggage, Jesus still sat down with them to eat. He still attended to their questions in secret meetings, such as with Nicodemus. The Pharisees had their share of problems, but who doesn't? Jesus was reaching out to them as well. He had come to save them as well. But that was a problem of pride. They thought they knew all they needed to know, heard every sermon they needed to hear. Jesus, speaking of them, said, "I did not come to save the righteous, but sinners." And this was not a compliment, because their righteousness was self-perceived and not reality. Makes me think about the pastor who was voted the most humble pastor in America. And the congregation gave him a medal that said, "To the most humble pastor in America." Then they took it away from him on Sunday because he wore it. Our righteousness may be self-perceived, but it may not be reality. Then the story takes a turn for the worse. Verse 37. A woman in that town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. You see, unlike the Pharisee who looked whitewashed on the outside, she did not. The Bible doesn't give her name, but it makes the point very clear on what kind of woman this was. It says a woman who lived a sinful life. And when you live a sinful life, everybody knows, especially in a small town. There's something about small towns that don't like. People judge you based on what side of town you live on. You're judged based on your family's history. And everyone seems to be so intimately connected that many times the criteria for success is not based on what you know, but who you know. Churches at times can become just like small towns. But that's a discussion for another day. But in an effort to protect her image, the Bible doesn't mention her name, but it does not protect her lifestyle, which it terms a sinful life. This woman brought with her a gift. Now, can you imagine this woman being in this small town with everyone knowing her business or what kind of business she was in? And then she went and to the home of a Pharisee, a separated one. Verse 37, I read it for you. He says, and behold, a woman in that city who was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at the table of the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of fragrant oil. But why? Why would she put herself in a place where people had pretensions about their own superior sanctity? And why would she go there knowing her lifestyle? Listen here. Because she had a gift for her Lord. This woman was grateful for what Jesus had done for her, and she was willing to endure ridicule, stares, whisperings, murmurings, because she didn't come for them, but she came for Jesus. I wish somebody's getting this. The woman busts through the party as an uninvited guest because she had a gift to worship Jesus with. Your reputation should not keep you from coming through these doors on a Sabbath morning when you have a gift for your Lord. Some of you are still not getting it. Don't let people keep you from coming to church just because they know you're there. Jesus accepts you. She came uninvited to a feast with a gift because her Lord was there. And where her Lord was, there she was too. It was an alabaster box of perfume containing spikenard. Now, spikenard is a scented perfume or ointment that was usually open on special occasions. You see there in Song of Solomon with the temple. In the New Testament, its expense is approximately 1 year's wages that is emphasized. About 1 year's wages. She takes this gift, and might I add, where would this woman find, how did she earn her wages? You better be careful when someone in surrender offers all they have to Jesus. I don't care how they got it. You better keep quiet. How would she find the money to buy this gift? She takes this gift and begins to wipe her hair up and down Jesus' feet as her tears moistens Jesus' feet, removing away dirt and debris. This woman wasn't trying to win salvation, but she was thankful for it. Let no one deceive you into thinking that just because you worship God on the Sabbath that you are trying by the law to earn your place in heaven. Don't let people or anyone fool you that since you started walking with Jesus, your changed life has become offensive and now you feel as if you are better than everybody else. Don't accept it. Push back on it. People don't know what it took for you to get where you are. Some may have been favored because of their family heritage. Others by their good looks. Others may have extraordinary talent. But to know what you had to go through to get where you are in this place in your life, it took some tears, if the truth be told. It took some prayer. It took some fasting. God has brought you into this place where you are. He has enlarged your territory, and don't let anyone confuse you otherwise or make you feel ashamed about it. You stand here by the grace of God. Amen. And in Luke chapter 7, verse 39, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would know who was touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner. You know, there's many things wrong about this statement, but But let's move it on. Let me assure you that whenever there is true worship, there is always someone who has something negative to say. There will always be people who always have something negative to say when you are doing something for God. But don't be discouraged, because true worship always contains a sacrifice. And many times, it's our preferences, it's our ideas on holiness, and our desire for control that must be placed on the altar. Even though true worship is criticized, the Bible says that the Father is seeking such to worship Him. The woman had a reputation. She was a former prostitute, and many criticized her worship, but Jesus never did. Why would she waste this costly bottle of fragrance on Jesus' feet when it could have gone to feed the poor? Why would she come to a house where she knows she wasn't wanted? Why would people take their hard-earned money and give it to the church? Why do I devote so much time to the church when I feel so unappreciated? Why? 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 We have to be very careful in worship, because that which we criticize may be something that God deems as good. Selfless, sacrificial love. For the time is coming that the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Simon's sin was unseen. This sinful woman's sin was obvious, but there was a man in that house who could read hearts. According to him, her condition wasn't as bad as Simon's. You see, Simon did a good work to invite Jesus to his house for dinner, but it was the eternal worth of this woman's gift that we have come to know this story before. Luke chapter 7, verse 40, Jesus answered him and said, "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Tell me, teacher," he said. "Two people owe money to a certain money lender. One owed him 500 denarii. Now, denarius, singular, it's about a day's wages. So if you do 500, that's a little over a year, right? The other, 50. It's interesting to know that the alabaster box was about a year's wages. Verse 42, neither of them had the money to pay him back. None of them could pay, whether it was 50 or whether it was 500. So he forgave the debt of both." Both were sins. "Now, which of them would love him more?" Simon replied, "I suppose." He's still struggling with the pride there. "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt forgiven." "You have judged correctly," Jesus said. Then he turned towards the woman. I'm assuming this is the 500 denarii person here. "Simon, do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wipe them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss." Verse 45, we're in Luke 7, chapter. Verse 45. "You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as her great love has shown. But whoever has been forgiven little, loves little. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless Simon was unloving, the woman was loving. Simon was censorious, the woman was penitent. Both of them, a debt with nothing to pay. But Simon was rebuked by our Lord. And this woman, this who the Bible calls sinful woman, was commended by our Lord. All because she got the true meaning of true worship. How is it that nobody can enter the kingdom before us? Because Jesus emptied himself. He made himself of no reputation, and he became a nobody for you and for me. John 13, verse 13 says, "You call me Master and Lord, and ye say well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example, that ye should do as I have done to you. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord, neither he that is sent greater than he that sent him. If you know these things, happy are ye if you do them." And hopefully, Ephesus, we give. That we give because he first gave. But what we are called to give will never outmatch the gift given to us in his Son, Jesus Christ. So the greatest gift that we have to give Jesus is our hearts. And today in this communion, do you want to give your heart to him again? Just raise your hand. You want to give your heart to him again. Let's pray. Father, if the truth be told, we are all just nobodies. Nameless individuals. But because of your mercy, we were headed down to the path of destruction. But because of your grace, we are here today. And we matter to you. Lord, we want to give our heart to you today. Some today may feel just like that sinful woman. They feel unworthy of your love. They feel unworthy of your grace and your mercy. But today, will you show them that you accept them and that you forgive them? You want to cleanse them and to make us whole. So that when you come in the clouds of glory, we'll be saved, washed, and clean by the blood of the Lamb. This is what we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.